Don't tell me not to live, just sit and putter. Life's candy and the sun's a ball of butter. Don't bring around a cloud to rain on my parade. Don't tell me not to fly, I simply got to. If someone takes a spill, it's me and not you. Who told you you're allowed to rain on my parade? I'll march my band out, I'll beat my drum. And if I'm banned out, you'll turn it back, sir. I guess I didn't fake it, had sir. I guess I didn't make it, but whether on the rose of sheer perfection, a dunk on the nose of life's complexion, the cinder of the shiny apple of his eye. I gotta try once, I gotta try once, only can die once. Alright, sir. Oh, life is juicy, juicy, and you see, I gotta have my bite, sir. Get ready for me, love, cause I'm a comer. March, my heart's a trauma. Don't bring around a cloud to rain on my parade. I'm gonna live and live now. Get what I want, I know how. One roll for the whole shebang. One throw, that bell will go clang. Eye on the target and wham. One shot, one gunshot and bam. Hey, Mr.
So now today we are reviewing Glee season 3. This is my first time ever watching Glee in 2011. So this is my first time ever watching Glee season 3, 10 years after its release, I believe. Yeah, 2011, 2021. Yeah. Let me just, first off, let me give a my thoughts on the character development. So this is something that I did last season to now. So I'm going to give a how the characters are progressing and how the characters have changed from season to season. I'm going to mash these two together. Rachel Berry and Finn Hudson played by Cory Monteith. I will say they actually didn't really annoy me this season, which is really crazy. To be honest, this time I wasn't really, you know. One thing I loved about Finn was the fact that he didn't really sing a lot, which, thank God, because he sucks as a singer, as I always said. No disrespect to Cory Monteith, but it's like, dude, some people aren't singers, you know, or you just need to train a little bit more. So, that's them. Let's talk about Santana Lopez, played by the late Naya Rivera, and who's that other girl? Brittany, played by Heather Morris. To be honest, I felt that Santana got a lot more, again, a lot more airtime. I feel like as every season progresses, she's getting more in the spotlight. Brittany, I want to say she was a lot more in the spotlight last season. I feel like she kind of took a backseat this season. So that's something that I just found out between them two. And let's Tina, and I don't know her last name, Tina and Mike Chang, where the fuck were they? They like literally were like MIA. They were not seen at all, which I found super weird. And we'll talk about Tina in quite a minute, but literally like they were not even, they were like crickets. Like they were gone. Like literally they're only used as bodies in the back of the Glee Club. So sorry. I feel so bad for them. Like literally it's like Tina was already a background singer, a background girl, but she's like a background. She's like an extra at this point. I feel like Mike Chang's only like moment in Glee, like in the season, his only main storyline was the fact that his dad was not accepting of him wanting to go to want to pursue dancing, and they, so that's his only main storyline. Tina's main storyline, bitch got none. She didn't get no storyline. Let's talk about Quinn Fabre, my girl Quinn Fabre. Oh, okay, first of all, I don't know what Quinn did to everybody. I don't know if the, you know what? Okay, this is what I think of. Did the real life actress who played Quinn, what's her name? Like Diana Agron. I don't know her actual last name. I'm sorry. But man, they did my girl dirty. Now, I love me some Quinn Fabre. Let me tell you, she is probably my favorite character on this show. But literally, it's so sad to see like how like, next to Finn and Rachel, or you know, next to the characters Finn and Rachel, she was like right behind them. You know, she was one of the, to be honest, the first season was literally like she had so much shit going on with her. She was pregnant, she was the cheerleader, she had a fit, you know, dealing with her pregnancy, being a bitch, you know, like spying on the Glee Club and sending the information to Sue. Like she was a main, she had a main storyline in the first season, and as the seasons go on, she's like, she's like literally like every time, every new season that goes on, she's like literally like being swept under the rug, and I feel so bad because it's like literally her first season was like she was pregnant, she was lying about the baby daddy, she was a bitch, she was mean to people, she was like the head cheerleader, head bitch in charge. The second season was literally just her, literally I feel like the second season was just her and her constant boyfriend swapping. Her third season, literally, okay, so she first comes in as like with a new look. She's like a goth girl now or something, a punk girl. And then like after that, she's like, I'm not joining Glee Club. And then after that, she joins Glee Club and she's not even heard of until she gets into a car crash and she's handicapped, which I knew she was going to get handicapped. I knew she was going to get into a car accident and be in a wheelchair because I was one time, I think, watching like, there's a YouTube video, I'll probably put it right here. It's called, I think it's like Quinn Fabre songs. And I was like listening to Quinn Fabre's music. And then somebody put, man, they did her so dirty because literally she was, again, she was like such a main cast member the first season. And then she gets into a car crash. This happens. I'm like, oh shit, she gets into a car crash. Did I think she would be paralyzed? I wasn't sure. I didn't think she would be. But anyway, I feel so bad for my girl Quinn because, man, I love me some Quinn. And then the fact that they gave her literally nothing to work with. The only time she was actually given, like, not necessarily solos, but her own songs to sing was literally when she was in a wheelchair. Like, literally, that was it. And I feel so sorry for this girl. Like, I'm like, homegirl was a high-profile girl. She was at the top next to Finn and Rachel because they were the main stars, but she was like right below, she was like right underneath them. She was one of the girls who had a main storyline, and now it's like they don't give a fuck about her. Let's talk about the cheerleaders, right? So okay, so of course the main cheerio girls are Santana, Brittany, and Quinn. The first season, Quinn was the top bitch, and Santana and Brittany were her little fucking backup bitches. As the season goes on, we're noticing that Santana is slowly taking Quinn's spot because Santana's getting more airtime. She's getting more storyline development, character development, and Quinn is just sitting up in here in her wheelchair, like totally like sidelined. Which, let's go to Artie. Where was he? He was like literally nowhere to be seen as well. He was completely absent. Like, did he even have a solo song that he sang? Probably not. Mr. Shu, I don't really feel like I saw a lot of him, to be honest. I feel like he was a lot more prevalent in the first two seasons. This season, he kind of like, again, kind of took a backseat. Emma, let's talk about Miss Emma. She's Emma. What else is there to say? Sue Sylvester, her character development, again, it's like, she wasn't really, I don't know if she was seen a lot this season, but I will say her demeanor has definitely changed. She's a lot more nicer, which I do kind of like. Some people said that the fact that Sue wasn't like rivaling the Glee Club, like I think they said that that's what made it terrible, like the season. But I personally did like that she was on their side. Kurt, let me say, he definitely stepped out and definitely went from like the backseat person to someone who actually had a storyline. Let me say, because the first season, he was like nowhere to be seen. Second season, he was kind of there, kind of not. And third season, like, he stepped out and they actually gave him something to work with. You know, he's in a relationship with Blaine now. And then they show him and his relationship with him, getting into Niada, all that stuff. So they actually gave him something to work with, which I actually like. And Blaine, let me, you know what, I feel bad because, you know, Blaine was, of course, he first came in season two, right? He came into season two and he wasn't a main cast member. They made him a main cast member the third season, right? What I feel so bad about is the fact that Tina was there from the get-go, right? She was there from the beginning. And then they give like freaking, they give Blaine like 5 or 6 or 7 solo songs. And how many does Tina get? How many does Artie get? Like dang, like they really stepped up. They really like took Blaine and was like, okay, Tina, we know you've been here from the start. Artie, we know you've been here from the start. Mike Chang, we know you've been here from the start. But you know, we're gonna accommodate Blaine and fuck all y'all three. Like, fuck all y'all character development because we're gonna give Blaine the spotlight. Like, poor Tina, okay? I feel so sorry for Tina because I will get to her in a minute. I will get to her in a minute. So, Mercedes, I want to say that she definitely was a lot more prevalent in the first half of the season. Well, the first like 6 or 7 episodes, she was a lot more prevalent when she was feuding with Rachel. But then when like she stopped feuding with Rachel, like, where was she? Puckerman, let me just say, I was at the first season, I absolutely despise Puckerman. Not as much as Finn and Rachel. But Puckerman, I could not stand him. But to be honest, I was rooting for him this season, man. There was a scene where he got into a fight with one of the hockey players. And I was like, come on, kick his ass, Puck, kick his ass. And he lost. But I was actually rooting for him. So yeah, Puck, oh my God, like he definitely did a, he's one of those people that did an absolute 360 where he was like such a mean person. See, and not like, I don't know. See, I can get down with a girl that's a bitch and a mean person, but a guy that's a bitch and a mean person, there's just something about them that I can't stand. But when the girls are bitches, hey Quinn, hey girl, you're my bitch. But when it's a mean dude, I can't fuck with you. I cannot fuck with you. We'll talk about side characters. I'm leaving out one character in particular that's in the main cast, but we'll talk about that in a minute. The first episode we start off is the Purple Piano Project. And this is basically, this episode consists of, we first start off and it's a new school year, right? And then we find out that Will is with Emma and they're living together. And something that I think about is, how long were y'all dating before y'all lived together? First of all, the school year is only 3 months basically, because the school year is July, June, July, and August, and you come back to school in September. So y'all telling me that y'all moved in with each other 3 months in? Child, please. With this episode, we get that they're together. We also get, we also find out that Tina and Artie are juniors, which I find crazy. I always thought that they were seniors along with like Finn, Rachel, Kurt. You know, I was surprised that they were juniors. You know what? So basically season one, when Rachel and Finn were sophomores, Tina was a freshman. Bitch didn't look like a freshman. You know what though? It's subtle things that I see. Because when you first look at Tina from season one, maybe I'll insert a picture here if I want to. Season one, she had like the blue hair. She was like she dressed gothic and da 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 da. And as the seasons went on, she got more of a natural look. It's not a phase, mom. It was for Tina. But that's something that I did notice. So good character development there, writers. In this episode, Santana and Brittany are back in the Cheerios. And Blaine actually moved to McKinley. So I'm pretty sure his parents are very, very happy. The fact that they don't gotta pay that fucking school tuition, which I still find pretty ridiculous, to be honest. Like, y'all really making your parents pay for your high schooling? See, if it was my mama, she would've been like, bitch, no. You can go to the public high school over there. Or you can go to the public high school over there. We ain't putting your ass in no private school. Sorry. Mine is, I would rather use that money to save it for college, maybe. But that's none of my business. So also, we find out that this was actually Lauren's last episode. So basically, they showed a clip of Lauren telling Puck that she was not going to be in the Glee Club anymore, which I love Lauren. I love Lauren. So like, that was her last appearance. It was only like a 30-second clip. RIP, Lauren. We won't see you again. Okay, so also this episode showed actually Rachel's biological mother, Shelby. She actually was coming in and she was going to... make her own Glee Club or something like that, like her own arts program. They were making an arts program for her. So she had a cast, so she was looking to cast, you know, people to join her Glee Club, but she made a deal with Mr. Shue saying that I'm not gonna go after any of your people, okay? And he's like, yeah, sure, we can do that. So what ends up happening is that Mercedes, I wanna say the first episode, how did this happen? I did not rewatch this episode. So I think what happens was, I think Mercedes was being like sick and tired of being in the background because of course Rachel's always in the foreground. And again, it's like, I don't know why the writers of Glee casted someone like Mercedes with an amazing voice just to have her sitting in the background. That's what I don't get. Because why are you going to cast someone as talented as Amber Riley played, or Mercedes played by Amber Riley? Why are you going to cast someone with that amazing of a voice when you're just going to put her in the background? Like, I'm sorry. So basically, I think Mercedes like went off on Mr. Shue saying like, you know, you always favor Rachel, you always accommodate her, blah, 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 blah. And she ended up joining Shelby's Glee Club. And then what ends up happening is that Santana ends up getting kicked out of Glee Club because Mr. Shue finds out she's back on the Cheerios. And he's like, I ain't trying to have you become a spy. Because I think she was going to become a spy when Sue told her. I think Sue gave Brittany and Santana an ultimatum. Like, are you going to join the Cheerios and be a spy? Or are you just going to be in Glee Club? And they chose to become a spy and be in Cheerios. So basically, Mr. Shue kicked her ass out, and then Brittany and Santana end up joining Shelby's Glee Club. So they have three girls so far. And also, something else that happened too was the first episode, Quinn comes out with like this weird ass look. First of all, the stylist need to get fired because that outfit looked ugly. I'm pretty sure if you're like a scene punk queen, I'm pretty sure there's outfits that look a lot better than what Quinn was wearing that first episode. It was tragic. And basically, Quinn was like a smoker, pink hair girl, saying like, I'm not going to join Glee Club anymore, blah, blah, blah. So she's more like aloof now. So we're moving on to episode 2, which is I Am Unicorn. So in this episode, So Shelby makes a couple appearances on the Glee Club, which to be honest, I actually really liked. I actually liked seeing more of Shelby, to be honest. But again, there's just like that very awkward thing. The fact that like she's Rachel's mama and why is she working at the same school as her daughter goes to school at? I find that really weird. So it's like the fact that she's working there with like the fact that her daughter is there, her fucking biological daughter. And she ain't hung up about it. You know what I'm saying? I find that really awkward. I'd be avoiding places not to see people. Cough attack. So, something that I found funny was the fact that I want to say that at this point, Sue wanted to get rid of the arts program. And her first, she wanted to make like a little documentary. And the first person that she thought of was getting Quinn, because Quinn is like a mess now. Because from being the head cheerleader to now like being like this smoking punk girl. So basically, Sue wanted to create a narrative that Quinn is like this because of the Glee Club, and they showed a clip of... So basically what happened was they were recording Quinn in Mr. Shue's office, and she was like saying like, I had everything, and it's Glee Club that destroyed it. And Mr. Shue was not having it. He went off on her ass. He was like basically telling her, all the choices you made is you. You got pregnant. You did this. You did that. And he's like, and when you were not popular, you didn't have that Cheerios uniform. When Sue kicked you out, who had your back? The Glee Club. He's like, did you even thank Mercedes for taking you in and letting you live with her? He's like, you need to stop making yourself a victim. And I was like, miss the shoe. Like, he did not just say that. But I love my girl Quinn Fabre, but bitch, she needed to hear it. As controversial as Tyra's, we were all rooting for you moment. Remember that moment? We all do, even if you're not a Top Model fan. One thing I will take from that moment, which I still agree with to this day, is take responsibility for yourself, because nobody is going to take responsibility for you. And that's the way I feel about that. It's like, homegirl, like, you made your choices. You chose to have sex. You got pregnant off of that. Like, you can't be blaming other people for your shortcomings, for your issues. You know what I'm saying? So, like, yeah, so that happened. This episode, too, I think Shelby, her main incentive about, you know, working there is to have Puck and Quinn visit the baby, Beth, because Shelby adopted their baby. So she's legally the mother now. So she basically kind of wanted them to have a relationship with Beth, the baby. And Shelby told Quinn that if she cleans up her act, then she can visit the baby, blah, 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 because Puck already visited the baby. And then Quinn ends up cleaning up her act. No more pink hair for Quinn. And I think she rejoins Glee Club at this point. And then she ends up telling Puck that, you know, I don't care. She's like, I don't care about you. She's like, the only reason why I joined Glee is so I can, like, so I can get my baby back. She's like, I want full custody of this baby, which... In reality, the fact that, like, Shelby already legally adopted the baby, I don't think you can take the baby back. But again, it's like, she don't know this because she's 17 or 18. But, you know, in the real world, you can't really do that. Anyway, so let's talk about the Asian F episode, which was basically like Chang got a B, which is an Asian F, and his dad was super pissed off about it, saying, like, you're not going to do any more extracurricular activities, Glee Club dance, because you need to get an A+ or whatever. And this is the episode where Mercedes goes off on Mr. Xu saying that he favors Rachel, which is true, which is fucking true. And we will get to that in a minute. You know what? No, let's talk about this now. So when they were going to, regionals, Mr. Xu was saying what they're going to do, right? And then he goes, Rachel, you're gonna have the solo. And then Tina comes up and is like, I want the solo. And then Mr. Xu's like, well, Tina, you will get your chance sooner or later. And Tina's like, I've been here for 3 fucking years. I started in this Glee Club and it's always Rachel gets the solos, which I agree with. You can't sit there and tell me that Mr. Xu don't play favorites. The fact that he doesn't even say, okay, there's an open audition for solos. He literally just picks and chooses who he fucking wants. And who does he always choose? Finn and Rachel. When let me just say, Finn, trash of a singer. Rachel, let me say, and to be honest, it's like they sleeping on my girl Tina because she knows how to fucking sing. Like, honestly, it's like, okay, I'm not trying to be like, I don't want this to come off the wrong way, but it's like, I personally don't really hear a lot of Asian women or men sing. I've never really, like, to be honest, it's like, there's not a lot of, like, well, there's K-pop and stuff, but people who can actually do, like, see, Tina got, like, that Broadway voice. Like, the way she sings, she can do Broadway, in my opinion. So, like, I never heard correct me if I'm wrong, you know, or introduce me to some people because I don't know. I never really hear a lot of Asian men and women doing Broadway type of stuff, which Tina has. One of my favorite performances of Tina that she's done, which wasn't really a performance, was season 1 when she was doing the Tonight by West Side Story. And she did that little clip of her singing. And then she was like, I was terrible. I was sharp. Because just because she fucked up the ending ever so slightly. That's one of my favorite moments of Tina because it really showed her vocal range, which I love. I like, and I practice that song to help with my vocal ranges. So, like, y'all sleeping on Tina because she is just as talented as Rachel. But again, it's like, it's all about who you put the spotlight on, because Mercedes has a great voice. Tina has a great voice, but who do you just put the spotlight on and favor? Rachel. Who had a great voice too? Sunshine. If they actually kept her in the season, which she would have been probably bigger than Rachel. But again, it's like they just keep it centered around her. Do that to the other talented people to make that one person have the spotlight. When in reality, it's like they can probably outshine you as, but they just keep them to the side so you can have all the spotlight. But whatever. Switch positions because, oh, my body hurt. So let's go to the Pot of Gold episode. So this is the episode where they introduced like this, like, what's his name? He's like a, was he Scottish? He was, it was like a foreign exchange student who was Scottish, right? I forgot his name. But I found that really strange how he just popped up out of nowhere. I literally thought he was just going to be like a one-time character, but he actually stayed for the whole season and he ended up joining Glee Club. I didn't really know what his main concept was. He is a good singer, I'm not going to lie. Better than Finn, literally. A cat getting strangled is better than Finn, but whatever. Something else that I really liked about this episode is ever since he got transferred to McKinley High, I noticed, and of course they called it out later, I noticed that Finn always had to make a face every time Blaine ever spoke or even said a word, even fucking breathed. Every time Blaine even had breathed, Finn is always like, I'm like, boy, like, what is your problem with him? And even Santana called his ass out. She's like, why the hell are you always freaking picking on Blaine? Like, what is your freaking problem? Because everything that Blaine has to say, Finn always has to counter it. This is still the area where Finn is kind of a douche. There was also another scene which I really like too, because, you know, Finn loves to always, he's the leader. He's like the top, he's the leading guy in the Glee Club, whatever. So what I like is the fact that he calls Brittany stupid, right? And then Brittany says, all the guys call me that, but you're the leader, which makes it worse. You want to say how you're a leader and you're like a man? Please. Also, because, you know, Puck has been visiting Little Miss Beth up in here, right? And what ends up happening is that Puck and Shelby end up kissing. Let's talk about the episode the first time. So what happens is, in the first time, Rachel and Blaine get casted for West Side Story. They're the main leads. They're the lead roles, right? And what ends up happening is this episode consists of the first time having sex, right? So then they basically, Artie's rhetoric was, in the West Side Story, there's a scene that's very sensual, very sexual, but he tells Rachel and Blaine, how can you portray that when you never had sex? You don't know what that feels like. And then basically, Rachel and Blaine put it in their minds that, oh my God, in order to play this role that has a sex scene in it, I have to have sex so I know what that feels like. Let me tell you, there's so much wrong with that statement. It's not verbatim what she said, but basically she's basically wanted to have sex so she's able to play a convincing role as Maria. Let me slap this dumb bitch right now. First of all, homegirl, you're acting. What is the definition of acting? You're acting as a different person. You're acting as a character. So you're telling me that you have to have... I don't know how many kids were watching this when it first aired. Because that is such terrible advice. And if those impressionable kids who don't think on their own look at that and they say, oh, well, you know, if I want to be an actor, I have to, and not only do I have to act the role, I have to actually do the role as well. Do the action so I know how to act with the action, if that makes sense. Let me tell you something. One of the most infamous movies out there, Silence of the Lambs, Hannibal Lecter, a man who is a therapist or a psychiatrist / serial killer because he eats humans and kills humans. Did the real life actor who played Hannibal Lecter go out and kill people and eat their brains and cook them? Did he do that because he thought to himself, oh, I have to play a serial killer, so guess what? I've never done that, so how can I play a convincing role? Let me kill a couple people. Her Rachel's rhetoric, the fact that this bitch really thought, oh, I need to have sex so I can play a convincing role. It's like, no, bitch, that's why it's called acting for a reason. That phrase completely turned me off. I was like, this bitch did not just say that. This bitch did not just say that. Because I was like I am right now. Speechless. The fact that this bitch really thought that. Long story short, she ends up having sex with Finn, and Blaine ends up having sex with Kurt. Was that like the first sex scene the first gay sex scene they ever shown on TV? I don't know. It wasn't really anything inappropriate. It was them in bed, not even caressing each other. So they had to keep it TV-14 because that was their rating. We also get introduced to a new character. He's not, throughout the season, he's not really a main character. He only makes like a couple appearances, and that is Sebastian. I don't know the actor who plays him. I should have looked that up. But I think Blaine ends up visiting his old high school, and Sebastian is like the new leader of the Warblers, and he basically is very flirtatious, very sensual with Blaine, and Blaine's like, I have a boyfriend, and basically Sebastian doesn't care. First of all, okay, let me just say, he is basically like the most villainous character that you're going to get from the season because everybody's so kumbaya. And I want to see the writers put him in there because they were like, I think the writers were like, okay, so Finn and Rachel aren't going to be the assholes anymore. So we have to have someone fill in the asshole role. So we need it to be Sebastian. And whenever Finn and Rachel are doing something stupid and asinine, we can always just reflect back to Sebastian. Anyway. Something that I think about that is I just find it so inappropriate and disgusting when there's somebody who is in a monogamous relationship and there's somebody who knows that's trying to get with that person. Because first of all, that just shows your character. Because, okay, let's put it this way. I'm pretty sure later on in the season, Blaine ends up cheating on Kurt with Sebastian, I think. Spoiler. But putting it this way, let's say Blaine and Kurt are dating, right? Let's say Sebastian's trying to like get with him and Blaine actually does it. Blaine now has to worry about Sebastian trying to get another man in another relationship. That's something you have to think about too. The fact that this man is trying to get you to cheat on him with him, it's like, how many other motherfuckers has he done that with? You know? And the fact that he's not even afraid to be the other man, like, you know, they have the other woman. The fact that he's not afraid to be that, that's really... You must think very low of yourself. You must think of yourself as the dirt on the floor if you're actually willing to put yourself in that position. And again, it's like the fact that he's actually willing to stoop that low and try to get with someone when he rightfully has a boyfriend, that is just garbage to me. I'm just like, that is gross because again, it's like, how would you feel if you're in, like, Sebastian, he's trying to get with Blaine when he's obviously with Kurt. How would you feel if, let's say, you get Blaine, right, and you and Blaine are dating? Let's say someone else is trying to get with Blaine. How would you feel about that? And that is exactly what, in season two, what, when Emma was dating that guy, Carlos, I'm the dentist. When Will was trying to get with Emma and the guy Carlos told Will, how would you feel if the roles were reversed? But again, it's like, Sebastian doesn't see it that way because he's obviously, Sebastian is probably one of those people where he doesn't care about it until it affects him. There you go. So, in order to, you know, try to seduce Blaine, Sebastian talks Blaine into going to a gay club, and Kurt tags along too. And that was like their first time ever going to a gay club or a gay bar or whatever. First of all, that scene, I don't know, like, it just, like, made me feel some type of way because I remember the first time I went to a gay bar. Let me just say, I never went underage. I want to say they were 18. They played 18-year-olds. So they went when they're underage. I never went underage. I waited till I was 21 years old. And It's such a crazy experience. I went by myself actually the first time ever. I was out at 10 o'clock at night wearing sunglasses, wearing a long fur coat, and I came in there walking like Lil' Kim from the Came Back For You music video. And it was such a crazy experience because I was so nervous and I went with nobody, so I had like no wingman or whatever. So I do, like, when I saw that moment, it was like, oh, it gave me like flashbacks to that first moment. I'm even smiling thinking about it. But we also see Karofsky at the gay club. Like, excuse me, first of all. I mean, it's Ohio. I'm pretty sure you could get a fake ID. Never once did I ever get a fake ID. I was going to actually get it one time when I was 18, but I did not. Okay, so let's talk about the Mash Off episode. So basically, this episode was consisting of the Trouble Tones, which are Shelby's Glee Club and New Directions, having a Mash Off where they compete and they find out, I guess, who the winner is. Whatever. So in this episode, the main storyline plots were the fact that Shelby and Puck, they're still together. And, you know, he's eyeing her and she's like, you know, so that thing. Also, I forgot to mention, too, in this season, let me say something about Quinn's character development. So she went from not giving a fuck to being like evil. To be honest, like, okay, I can fuck with her being a bitch. Okay, that's something like, yeah, girl, you do your thing. Be a bitch. Do you. But what happened was, in order to get Beth back, she was gonna plant some things in Shelby's apartment so she can call DCF and they can take the baby away and give it to Quinn. Like, how evil is that? Like, I was like scared. I was like, this bitch really is gonna do that? And Puck ends up like, I think she planted like weed in her apartment. Like, I think, and also like cannibalism books or something, like Satanism books, like Quinn put that in there, and Puck ends up taking them out, and Puck ends up telling her about it, Shelby, about it, because that's evil. Quinn went from being a bitch, like being like one of the like the head bitches, which I live for, to being a complete like evil person. I was like, Quinn, what are you doing? But, you know, it ends up not going through. And then they do an Adele mashup. When this episode first aired, I do remember the mashup specifically, because it was the Rumor Has It, Someone Like You. And that was like my first ever taste of Adele. I remember first hearing that song. And I thought that literally was a song, like Adele's song, but I didn't know there were two separate songs in a mashup. The next episode is I Kissed a Girl. And basically, this episode is basically about when Santana comes out of the closet, right? So, Shelby and Puck actually, I think, sleep together. I think. Also in this episode, again, I'm just like, Quinn is a goddamn mess. This in thirds. The first third of the season, messy as fuck. Second half of the season, wheelchair cripple. Third half of the season, she became humble. That's all I think about when it comes to Quinn. And I feel so sorry for her ass. Also, in this episode as well, last season, Coach Beast was dating this guy. I forgot his name. But Sue ends up taking him from her. And also this episode, too, in the Pink Unicorn episode, Kurt is actually running for, like, class president or something, because he wants to put something on his NIADA application sheet. You know what I'm saying? So he wanted to run for class president. But Brittany ends up running, too, and Rachel as well. But Rachel ends up dropping out, and all the votes seem like they were going to go to Brittany. So what Rachel does is she stuffs the ballot box and cheats. But what happened was they basically figured it out, because they noticed that there was more votes for Kurt than actual students in the school. And they were accusing Kurt of stuffing the ballot box, and he was going to get suspended and all this stuff. And he was afraid of that. So Rachel ends up owning up to it, which I find crazy, because the fact that they suspended her, and also they said she couldn't perform at sectional. So I was really surprised by that. I was like, wow. Like, I was actually really surprised that Rachel did that, because again, she's not known to be that type of girl, you know? She's not known to be taking ownership of shit sometimes. So yeah, so basically she got banned at sectionals, which I was thinking, thank God, can you please give someone else the spotlight? Because I'm sick of having her always steal the spotlight. The next episode is called Hold On to 16. And this episode is basically Quinn is trying to get Shelby fired, which Shelby ends up just leaving voluntarily. And also, this is what I didn't mention in character development. So they were trying to find members for like sectionals or whatever. And they were saying like, we should find Sam. And I was thinking too, I'm like, the first thing I thought of was like, y'all didn't cast Sam back? Okay, you're not gonna cast the hottest guy on the show back? Okay. So they end up finding him, and I want to say they ended up finding him in Kentucky. I don't really remember, either Kentucky or Tennessee, one of those places. And oh my god, motherfucker was a go-go dancer. He was like at the strip joint making that money in his underwear, and I was like, first of all, let me also say as well, something I didn't know as well, he's actually a junior in high school. First of all, you should not be doing that stripping when you're like 16, 17, because those are the ages that you are when you're a junior in high school. He don't look like a junior as well, which I was surprised that he was actually casted as a junior so he can stay at McKinley High for another year. Crazy. But, ugh. He got me so wet. Like, so now that Sam is back at McKinley High, Quinn is trying to get with Sam. And I'm like, girl, don't even try it, girl. Like, stop. Like, just focus on you. Stop trying to tie yourself down to a man. And he ends up just kind of telling her like, girl, no. Because what ends up happening is he wants to get Mercedes back, which I find that such a weird pairing. I just feel like they just mashed two people together and was like, okay, we're gonna create a relationship with y'all. I don't know. I find that really strange that they actually got a pairing together. I mean, I found it weird the fact that Mercedes even like Kurt, so that's even weirder. So I guess Sam is a step up from Kurt. In this episode as well, they have the sectionals episode where the new direction song choice, I don't remember, but it was very meh to me. And then they also sang the song We Are Young, which is one of the songs, very few songs from Glee that I remember. And to be honest, I kind of like the Glee version better. I've been warming up to Glee songs, actually. I have been having a couple Glee jams up in my phone. I'll talk about another one that I really like at the end of the episode. But yes, definitely, I've been into some of the Glee songs now. Yes. Okay. So then, the next episode is Extraordinary Merry Christmas. I mean, half the episode was in black and white anyway. It was like a film type of thing. Yes/no. So then basically this is the episode where, you know, Mercedes and Sam talk about their whole fling that they had over the summer. They talk about that with their little clique of groups. We also find out that Becky likes Artie. They end up going out on a date, but he doesn't pursue a second date with her. We also find out that Coach Beast eloped with the guy that Sue took away from her. So she professed her love to him. They ended up eloping after like, what, 2 days of dating? That's Glee for you. So then Sam, hot guy Sam, ends up joining the water polo team, and whoo, he is so fine. This is also the episode where Mr. Shu wants to propose to Emma, right? And then something else I forgot to mention too is that Mr. Shu actually meets Emma's parents, right? He meets her parents. And they show that basically Emma's parents are crazy. And they show that the reason why Emma has compulsive disorders is because her parents always made her clean her food when someone that was not a ginger would serve them. Or like, if someone that wasn't ginger, like, touched something of that they had a like secondhand touch, they had to wipe their hands and stuff. When I originally thought that in the first season, Emma said the reason why she was so OCD was because she fell in cow manure or something like that. I don't know. We will talk about the contradictions of Glee in a minute, because I'm going to get to this too. So Mr. Shu asks Finn if he could go with him ring shopping, right? And then this was something that I did see, I think I want to say either on like a Watch Mojo article or like a BuzzFeed article about like top reasons why Mr. Shu was a creep or something like that. And basically Mr. Shu asks Finn to be his best man. And it's kind of suspicious because it's like, dude, you don't got no male relatives that are over the age of like 25. You don't got like, you don't have any male friends. You're going to ask like one of your students to be... That's a little weird. Not going to lie. That's a little bit weird. But oh my God, I love this line. So he tells Finn, you taught me more about being a man than everyone I've ever known. So you want to be like, oh, Finn, you're the man. You taught me. The fact that Finn always was worried about his reputation being popular. The fact that when Kurt was getting bullied by Karofsky, you didn't want to insert yourself because you're like, I don't want to mess with Karofsky. And Sam had to step in. Sam, the man, literally rhymes. Sam, the man, had to fucking go and defend Kurt. The fact that Finn cheats on Quinn with Rachel. The fact that Finn cheats on Rachel with Quinn. The fact that Finn, when he needs to stand up for what is right, he doesn't do it. The fact that fucking Finn always has to pick on anybody, like has to pick on Jesse, has to pick on Blaine. It's like, motherfucker, it's like, this is your man. This is the person that you want to emulate. I'm sorry, but Sam is the better man, okay? Sam is the better man, period. Mr. Shu also told him, you stand up for your friends. Wait? Like, yeah, I didn't see you standing up for Kurt when he needed you the most. And I put, what about Kurt? What about quitting Glee? Flirting when you have a girlfriend. But we also find out, which is really weird, the fact that Finn's dad actually died of an overdose, which is like kind of foreshadowing. Consider that the real life actor Cory Monteith actually died of an overdose. It's kind of weird. So then they show a clip where Mr. Shu ends up proposing to Emma, and they do like this whole scene in the pool, like synchronized swimming type of thing. And actually, the proposal actually gave me goosebumps. I'm not gonna lie. And then one of the most shocking things, I was surprised, genuinely surprised. Finn proposes to Rachel, and they do like a cliffhanger scene. So then we roll back to the next episode, which is called Michael. So basically, this episode is a bunch of Michael Jackson numbers, and it's basically like the Warblers versus New Directions. And they end up having a mashup or like a dance, like a glee off, a sing off, I guess you can say, where they do a Michael Jackson number, right? So like the Warblers in New Directions meet at the parking lot and they start dancing it out, right? And at the end, Sebastian grabs a slushie and tries to throw it at Kurt, but he ends up throwing it in Blaine's face. And apparently it had something in there that like literally like scratched his cornea and he needed to get surgery. I was just like, that shit is shady as fuck. And then later on, there was a scene where Santana confronts Sebastian and they have like a Michael Jackson off. And then Santana like confronts him saying like, we know you put something in that slushie, and he confesses. And I had a feeling that Santana had a wire on herself, right? And then she reveals it to the Glee Club. And then fucking Kurt is like, oh, I don't want him to get disqualified. I want to beat him at his face. I was like, no, bitch, send his ass to prison. His ass could go to the state penitentiary and be someone's motherfucking butt candy. I want that. Like, I would have done that shit, honestly. But not everybody thinks the way I do. In this episode as well, Quinn applies for Yale and she gets in. So basically, what that tells me is the fact that Quinn's going to go to, what, Connecticut or something? I think that's where Yale is. So Quinn is going to go to Connecticut, and she's going to be written off the show. Sad. Very sad, because I love my Quinn. And then what ends up happening is that I think, I want to say Rachel tells Quinn about, you know, the whole proposal thing. And Quinn ends up kind of telling Rachel that breaking up with Finn is kind of like, she ends up saying how like marriage is not a good idea because, you know, Rachel told her, you know, like, I want to say like Rachel told her, like, he proposed to me, what, you're the most honest person I know, what should I do? And Quinn basically said, keeping him is kind of like an anchor holding you back, which I kind of agree with, to be honest, because when you're in a relationship, here, one of the most infamous lines from Jade Cole from Cycle 6 of America's Next Top Model, love is such a wonderful thing, but it'll kill you. I think that's what she said. Because when you're in a relationship, it's like, it's not about you anymore. It's about you and that other person. So like, let's say, for example, Rachel, she wants to go to New York and become a Broadway singer. If that's not his dream, she has to kind of, if he doesn't want to go to New York with her, she has to compromise. Like, what am I going to do? You know what I'm saying? So it's like, it's all about compromising. And I always say this, when you're in a relationship, I say these three things. It makes you die faster with all the bickering that you do. You get fat because you're going out all the time eating and spending time with each other. So you don't have, you're spending more time with them, which will be spending less time at the gym. And number three, they hold you back from your dreams because you have to compromise. What if you want to travel the world and they don't? What are you gonna do? Stay with them or break up with them and travel the world? You can't have one or the other if they don't want the same incentives that you do. So love is such a wonderful thing, but it'll kill you. And this is like probably the first episode in like, what, this is like, we're already like 10 episodes in and Quinn finally gets a goddamn solo. So the next episode is the Spanish teacher, which is basically like the Ricky Martin episode. And I got a couple things to say about this episode too. Sue wants to have a kid, which I find really, really strange. And she wants Will to be the sperm donor, which is really, really, really strange. And what I find so funny is the fact that, so the water polo coach is Nene Leakes. And when she finds out that Sue wants to have a baby, she wipes her from one end from the other, saying that, how can your old ass have a baby? When your baby's born, he's already going to be grown, a grown-ass adult, accounting. Like, she wiped her. She wiped her ass. And then also in this episode too, Finn is very much like defeated. Like, he doesn't know what he's going to do with his future. He feels like his future's over, when it's like, boy, you're 18. You have a lot more that you're going to do. Well, at that time you were, you know what I'm saying? Also in this episode too, so basically Mr. Shu got a complaint about, I guess, like the fact that he doesn't invest enough time in his Spanish course because he's also a Spanish teacher too. And what happens is, I want to say Ricky Martin and Mr. Shu have another sing off where they have to do like a Spanish song, right? And you know, Ricky Martin, he danced with Santana, right? And they were just doing like a dance number. That was it. Mr. Shu comes up and he's like a Spain dancer. He's like a bullfighter. He has like the costume and everything. And Santana's just sitting there like. And Mr. Shu finds out that the complaint that he got was from Santana. And she told his ass off. She put him in his place because she was like saying like, because in the beginning of the episode of the Spanish teacher, Mr. Shu was dressed up like in like a mariachi outfit. And he was singing La Cucaracha, which again, I found that so stereotypical. And it was addressed to by Santana. She's a typical dance, in these stereotypical costumes, you know? And that's what I think of too. Because when I looked at the performances of Ricky Martin and Will Schuster, Ricky Martin wasn't dressed up as like this whole costume and charade and shit. He was just literally singing and dancing like a normal person. But Mr. Shu comes in with the stereotypical costume and all that stuff, which doesn't bother me personally, but again, you also have to remember where it's like, you know, for us native Spanish speakers, Santana, I'm not sure in her character, she's a native Spanish speaker. I am a native Spanish speaker. Spanish is considerably my first language, but I speak English a lot better than Spanish. So, like the fact that like you have someone who doesn't even speak Spanish authentically teaching a Spanish class to you when you're trying to learn. You know, because it's like, what does that tell you for all the other children the kids who don't know Spanish that want to learn, but they have someone who speaks half-assed Spanish that doesn't know the authenticity of speaking Spanish, which Do you have to be authentic to teach it? No, but at least have a knowledge of it. Because I don't think Will's that great of a Spanish teacher. By what I hear, he barely speaks it. So it's like, get it together. So let's talk about the episode Heart, where again, they have to talk about the greatest love songs. Never once did I hear a Sade song come about, because Sade is probably one of the greatest women to have love songs. So this is also the episode where Rachel's parents find out that she's engaged, and they reveal Rachel's parents for the first time. This is the contradiction. They had this one guy and this other guy that looks like Jeff Goldblum. I don't know if that was Jeff Goldblum. But in the first episode of Glee, I could have sworn Rachel's parents were white and black. Tell me why these two white guys were on my TV screen. Tell me why these two white guys were on my TV screen when in the first episode they showed a picture of Rachel with her two dads and one of them was black, I want to say. I found that really strange. You really thought I forgot. I didn't forget. You really thought the people watching Glee would forget? Not me, bitch. Not me. So then Rachel ends up telling, you know, the people in Glee Club also that they're engaged, and they had a lot of opinions to say, to be honest. And do I think that teen marriage is a good thing? No. But they were very overbearing with their like opinions about it, because to be honest, the way I think about it is, even though you may not think it's a good idea, you have to let your friends make decisions on their own. So, and it's not like, and I don't want to put this in the wrong way, like it's not that you're setting them up to fail, but it is more so, you need to let your friends make their own mistakes. You cannot hold their hand through everything in life, you know? Even though you may think that something's wrong or something's a mistake, you have to let them walk through life. Make their own decisions. Same thing with a parent and a child. Sometimes you have to let your child free and make their own decisions. You know, they'll come back. They'll come back and ask for advice. You can give advice, but it's like, it's up to the other person to take it. And it's up to the other person if they want to take your advice. So it's like, if I was in that position, I would have told Finn and Rachel, like, no, I think that's a stupid idea. But if that's what makes you happy, go for it. Because it's not my life. It's not my decision to make for you. Let me tell you, one time I was talking to this one guy and he was talking about how like this guy asked him out, right? And this guy was like, I already knew he was a douche. By the way, they didn't work out anyway. He just used him for sex. But anyway, he told me, should I go out with him? He's so hot. And I told my friend at the time, dude, like, I ain't your daddy. It's like, you make your own decisions. I told him, like, do what you think is best. And he went out with him and he got screwed. And guess who was there? Saying, passive aggressively saying, I told you so, me. So yeah, that was that. Something else that happened too was there was a whole scene about Santana and Brittany getting called into the principal's office for doing PDA when Rachel and Finn weren't called into doing PDA. So they thought it was like a homophobic attack. Also in this episode too, you know, basically Blaine is on bed rest because he's getting surgery and his eyes fucked up. So I want to believe around Valentine's Day. So Kurt keeps getting like love notes from a gorilla saying secret admirer. And, you know, Kurt's like, oh, it's from Blaine, blah, 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 blah. But I have a feeling it was not from Blaine. What ends up happening? The gorilla reveals himself and I guess Karofsky. And guess who it was? Karofsky. And basically, you know, Kurt rejects him, basically saying, I have a boyfriend. And then somebody from Karofsky's school ends up seeing Karofsky. And it gets really awkward from there. Next episode. Next episode is on my way. And we find out that Sue's pregnant. And it's again, this is just another episode of Sebastian being like a little bitch. He ends up like superimposing a picture or photoshopping a picture of Finn's face on like a body, of a body, which is underwear on and high heels. And basically Sebastian said that if Rachel didn't quit for, I want to say regionals, then they would post the picture and it like ruined Finn's reputation. When in reality, Finn was freaking out about it. But if I was Rachel, I would have said something like, actually, that's not accurate because Finn has a tattoo right here. I would have said something stupid like that. You know what I'm saying? to kind of debunk it. Because, I mean, look at me. Like, if they try to superimpose a picture of me on, like a body with, like, a dick on it, and it wasn't me, I'm like, I got a tattoo here, I got a tattoo here, I got a tattoo in the back, and I got a tattoo on my knee. Did you put all those pictures, did you put all those tattoos in there? Because that's how I know it's not me. Which also is also a catch-22, because I can't, not that I ever do, I can't send nudes because I'm branded. So when I make it big out there, I ain't trying to get clowned and exposed. So basically, the next scene, there's a scene where Karofsky goes to the locker room, and he's going to his locker room, and he stops, and he's, like, shocked. And I'm like, oh, like, they wrote, like, fag on his locker or something. They wrote, like, homosexual on his locker. Guess what happened? They did. And Karofsky was so distraught by it that he ends up attempting suicide. And, you know, Kurt kind of blames himself for it because he's like, Karofsky was calling me and I, like, wasn't paying attention to his calls, blah, 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 blah. So, you know, Kurt visits Karofsky and... So Kurt visits Karofsky and basically says, you know, like, I want to be friends with you. Like, let me know if you need any help, blah, 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 blah. Yeah. And then they also showed a clip too, because, you know, Sebastian was, this whole episode, Sebastian was being a little bitch, but then he was like, you know, trying to be nicer. And they showed a clip of Sebastian telling, I want to say, Karofsky, like at the gay club or something, like, you know, dude, you're like 100 pounds overweight. Your eyebrows are plucked too thin. He's like, what makes you think that any guy will like you? You should just stay in the closet. I can already tell that Sebastian's going to grow up he's going to grow up to be the type of gay man who hates feminine gay men, fat gay men, black gay men. He's the type of person that only likes white mask gays or white skinny mask gays. He looks like one of those people. He's like, he's the type of guy on his Grindr profile that's going to say no blacks, no femmes, no fats, no Asians, no fucking Middle Eastern. Just all I want. White, muscular and mask, or white, slim and mask. That's going to be Sebastian's options, because guess who he has a hots for? Blaine, who is white, slim and mask. Making my bird sing up in here. So then also something happened where Mr. Shu has like a powwow session, and he tells like the people in Glee Club, like, what are you looking forward to the most? And then something that I found so crazy is the fact that Blaine said, I'm looking forward to marriage equality. And the fact that it happened 4 years after that was said, which is crazy. Crazy. Yeah, that was really crazy. Anyway, something else that I find super crazy is the fact that, because they were talking about, you know, with Karofsky's suicide attempt, Mr. Shu was talking about how he almost committed suicide because he was caught cheating on a test and his dad found out. I know it's a TV show, but if you're gonna get hung up on something that trivial, that is such a small thing. Like, I was caught doing way worse than cheating on a test. Okay, you know what I'm saying? It's like, I don't know. It's like the fact, like, you wouldn't think that you would want to commit suicide if you, like, committed a murder, or, like, let's say, like, I don't know, like, you committed a bank robbery. You wouldn't think that that was a lie. Like, not saying that those are justified reasons. This is a tough, touchy subject. All I'm saying is that if you really are so fragile that you are considering ending your life just because you cheated on a test and got caught, I'm sorry, that is just, like, I know that's a little bit, like, touchy, a touchy subject, but I find that really crazy, the fact that someone's contemplating whether or not they should live or not just because somebody caught them cheating on a test. I'm pretty sure the people who watched that found that ridiculous as well, not just me. So in this episode, Rachel and Finn were actually going to get married, I want to say by courthouse, I'm not really sure. So they had all the bridesmaids. Quinn was on her way, she just needed to get her dress. And, you know, Rachel was texting Quinn, like, girl, where are you? We about to start. And Quinn was going to text, I'm on my way. And then, kablooey, she gets into an accident. And my heart just dropped. I was like, ugh. Something else I forgot to mention too. In the episode where, in the greatest love song episode, the Valentine's Day episode, Quinn is in like not the celibacy club, it's like a Catholic club now. And there's this guy with dreads and has long hair. And I was like, oh, he's so pretty. He's like so pretty, you know? Oh, it's called, I think, the God Squad. So I want to say Mercedes, Sam, Quinn, and that guy, Joseph. I think that's his name. He was in it, right? See, this is a guy where I feel like I can relate to, because he's like a guy who's pretty. You know what I'm saying? He's not like that hot. He's not a Sam where he's like hot and like, ooh, you know, like he's not like that. He's not like the type of guy where it's like sexy, hot. He's like a pretty boy. And I consider myself to be like a pretty boy, to be honest. Like Michael Kelso from That 70s Show said, I'm what's considered man pretty. That's me. Like, I don't consider myself to be like a hunk or hot. I find that weird when people actually say that about myself, which I consider myself to be a man pretty, man beautiful. Because I consider those terms to be more like female, but I consider that about myself, like man pretty, whatever. But I'll talk about this in a minute. But remember that the Scottish guy, I forgot his name, and that guy Joseph. And then in the episode Big Brother, it was basically the main consensus of the episode was Blaine's brother was visiting, and Blaine's brother is like this like A-lister, I guess, A-list commercial guy, and Blaine is like kind of jealous of him because his brother's always criticizing him. The only comment I have to say was Blaine's number for Fighter by Christina Aguilera was terrible. Next episode is Saturday Night Gleaver. And okay, so this is the episode again where it's like I have to give props to Glee's inclusivity to all walks of life, because we get introduced to this guy named Wade who wants to perform, I want to say for sectionals or regionals, there's too many of those shits, or nationals, as a woman, as unique. But the way it's looked at is that Wade is basically transgender, because Wade says, you know, that he wants to be female. That's what he says. And sorry if I'm like getting the pronouns wrong, but you know, he's presented as male, but he's saying how he wants to be a she, he wants to dress up as unique and blah, 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 blah for regionals or whatever. And let me tell you, this motherfucker ends up doing it. And that motherfucker's voice, I almost fell out of my goddamn chair. I was like, oh my God, like he sounds amazing. Like Unique, girl, Unique. Oh my God. Oh my God. And we find out that Unique is actually part of Vocal Adrenaline with Jesse St. James, which I surprisingly found out was gay in real life. I didn't know that. He played a straight role very, very well. Next episode is Dance with Somebody, which is basically the tribute to Whitney Houston, which was actually maybe the year that she died, because they were doing tributes to her. Let me just say, I'm sorry. The Whitney Houston numbers were garbage. The only one that, whenever Mercedes was singing the Whitney Houston numbers, they were amazing. Everybody else, trash. So they also showed another segment where, you know, where Kurt is like at, I don't know, like a music shop or something, and he runs into this guy who like has a crush on him. His name is Chandler. They end up talking and texting, and Blaine ends up getting jealous, saying, why are you texting this guy? That's cheating. When, to be honest, not really. And then Kurt tells him, well, I wasn't getting up in your business when you were calling Sebastian and meeting him for coffee. And then, yeah, that whole situation happened. But nothing, Chandler was just like a one-time thing, and it didn't even end up progressing. We also find out that Quinn likes Joseph, the long hair guy. So let me speak on this really quick. So we had three new characters in Glee. We had the long hair guy, Joseph. Quinn likes long hair guy. Girl, stop liking guys, okay? You already had like 30 boyfriends. So we get introduced to a long hair guy, Joseph, Wade, and a Scottish guy. I don't remember his name. Scottish guy. I don't know his name. So with research, I ended up finding out that they were people who actually competed in the Glee project. I don't know if I'm going to do reviews on the Glee project, but they apparently, the winners or people that were in the Glee project got a chance to be like in some episodes. So I guess that was what happened with them, because I didn't know who they were actually until I looked them up and I found out that, you know, Unique and Joseph were actually part of the Glee project. Which then we get to the episode of Choke, which basically this episode is mainly about domestic violence, which I will be speaking about. We'll talk about that in a minute. So with that episode, basically this episode was consisted of Niada auditions. Kurt killed his audition. Rachel choked, which was crazy. And let me tell you, I know she performed the song Don't Rain on My Parade in, I want to say, season 2. One of my favorite songs. Been listening to that song on repeat a la the beginning. But this is what I want to talk about. So what ends up happening is that Coach Beast, we find out that her husband is hitting her and he's physically assaulting her. And she said a line where I think they were telling her, why don't you just leave him or something? She said, I can't leave him because I don't think anybody else will love me. I cannot tell you, when she said that, I was going to stop everything and make the video right then and there. I was so hot. I was ranting in around my house for like 30 minutes. But we'll talk about why I didn't do that. Let me just say, for those of you out there, because again, I think about the children who watch it, because I was like a kid when this came out, right? I was a kid. I was a baby. Okay, I will say this line was later redeemed later on, but something that I think about is looking at this as an adult, I think to myself, do you believe that about yourself, or is your abuser making you believe that? Because there's a lot of mind manipulation when it comes to abusive relationships. There's a lot of psychological abuse too, where they tell you you're not good enough, you're not going to find anybody better, you're useless. The person getting abused may believe that about themselves. But let me just say this right now. When Coach B said that, I thought to myself, like, why? So you said nobody will love me the way this person is. It's like, start with loving yourself first, because when you love yourself, you would not put yourself through that. And I've never been in that situation. So of course, again, it's like, I'm not trying to be insensitive about the topic, but again, it's like, if nobody will love you the way that that person does, why don't you give that to yourself? You don't need anybody to love you. You don't need people. You don't need to be validated by all these people. One of the biggest things, one of the biggest presents I gave to myself, I want to say a year ago or 2 years ago, is the fact that, okay, so in that situation, I feel that, again, the most important person that you have to prioritize is yourself, because again, people come and go. So at the end of the day, you have to love who you are. And I'm a big, big believer in RuPaul's quote, you have to love yourself before you love anybody else. Because how can you expect to give someone all this love and affection when you can't give that to yourself? You don't respect yourself enough to say, I'm not going to go through this. I'm not going to tolerate this. I deserve better. Why are you settling for somebody who's abusing you mentally, physically, just because you're afraid that nobody else will love you the way they do? When in reality, again, that could be the abuser putting that psychologically on you. But again, you have to remember that, who's going to love you? I don't think anybody else will love me. Love yourself first. Love yourself. One of the biggest, like I said, one of the biggest presents I gave to myself was that I've come to realize, even at a young age, I don't need a man to validate me. I don't need a man to make me feel special. I can do that to myself. Anything that you think you could do in a relationship, I can do that for myself. I can give myself compliments. I can buy myself presents. I can make myself feel worthy. I can make myself feel loved. I can motivate myself. I can motivate myself to achieve my incentives. I am able to go to a movie theater by myself and be okay with that. You know, like, I'm somebody where I don't put that stigma on myself that when you're single, you're lonely. I feel like there's a lot of people out there who are afraid to be by themselves and live and go through life alone, that they would rather be with somebody and settle for less, or be with somebody who is abusing them, whether that's mentally, psychologically, emotionally, because they would rather go through that than be by themselves. I'm somebody where I let love come to me. I don't care if it never comes to me, honestly. At the end of the day, I love myself. And to be honest, I know this sounds very narcissistic. If I can date me, I would, because I know that I can give what I would want in a relationship. I can give, I can be romantic. I can be uplifting. I can be an ear to listen. I don't argue with your petty ass because I don't give a fuck about arguing with you. I'm an uplifter. I'm a motivator. I'm able to I'm able to respect you as a person. I'm able to take accountability. I'm able to have integrity. That is the qualities I give in a person, and I would like that back for myself. I'm a gentleman. I pay for the first date. I pay for the second or whatever. If you, I will take my credit card out and put that shit right there without you even knowing or asking. So it's like all that shit that I do for other people, yeah, I want that for myself. And again, it's like you should not settle for less. You should strive for the best. You should think very highly of yourself. And Witch Beast already knew that wasn't okay, but the fact that she already psychologically thought in her mind, well, I don't think anybody else will love me, so I'm gonna stick with him. It's like, what type of life is that to live? Baby girl, love yourself then. Why don't you stop relying on other people to love you and love who you are first, because you should love yourself first, because you live through this entire life in your body. You should love who you are because you live through this life. You know yourself the best. You know who you are because you lived this life the longest. And the fact that she feels like she has to settle for him really, really, really set me off, honestly. They even agree too. That really set me off, and that really, like, I was like heated when she said that, because I was like, you should love who you are. And again, it's a very touchy subject, because it's like, again, there's people that are like, just leave. No, I would not say, of course, like it's easier said than done. You know what I'm saying? I've never been in that situation, so I would not know. But again, the fact that she thinks that is so sad to me, because it's like, you are just like, it's very damaging to you psychologically and mentally if you think that. And again, even if that wasn't the case, let's say like he wasn't abusing her. That's saying that is no excuse to stay in a relationship just because you feel like nobody else will love you. Let's say, like, for example, the person is cheat. Let's say this person is not abusing you. Let's say if this person is just cheating on you, or maybe you're just not in love with that person anymore. Let's say things are dry. You haven't had sex in 5 years. Don't ever think you have to stay in these relationships just because you're afraid that no one else will love you. Why are you settling for someone just because you're afraid that you won't find anybody better? It's like, if you can't find anybody better for that time being, love yourself. That's what it is. Love yourself. A relationship is a luxury, not a necessity. Okay? Loving yourself is a necessity, not a luxury. Okay? You should love yourself so you know what you want. Like I said, for me, Carrie Bradshaw from Sex and the City, single and fabulous, question mark. I am single and fabulous, exclamation point, because one of the best things that you can learn is the fact that you don't need to be tied down to a man to feel validated, to feel like you matter. I don't need a man to go out in public places. I don't need that to feel validated to myself, because I already take it upon myself to feel that way, to love who I am, to validate myself, because I can do that on my own. Because baby girl, you're gonna walk through this life on your own one day. And I walked through this life for X amount of years and decades, and I'm able to do it for another 20 or 30, 40, 50, 60 years. If I'm gonna do that on my own, well, whatever. I love myself. And again, it's like I said about relationships, they hold you back. So am I open to love? Yes. Am I going to go look for it? No. It could come to me. That's just the way I feel about the whole situation. Rant over, and we'll talk about this later on. So the next episode is Promosaurus. Basically, in this episode, they're doing who's going to be prom queen, prom king, blah, 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 blah. So Finn ends up running with Quinn because him and Quinn got nominated for prom king, prom queen. And he wanted to run with Quinn because he felt bad for her because she's in a wheelchair. Happening is that Quinn doesn't end up being the prom queen after all. The nominees were some random girl that we never heard about, Santana and Quinn. And the prom kings were a hockey player, Finn, and another guy. I forgot who the other guy was. But Finn ended up winning prom king, and surprisingly enough, Rachel ended up winning prom queen. Surprising. Anyway, next episode is props. So this is the episode where Tina stands up for herself. She ends up saying, so basically, you know, they do a whole recap about how Tina's just been sidelined, which it's totally immaculate. And this is the episode where Tina goes off and says, you know, Rachel gets all the goddamn fucking solos, da 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 da. And then Mike Chang, who's supposed to love and be together with Tina, is like on Rachel's side because she's like a senior. And the fact that all 3 years that Rachel was in Glee Club, she always got the solos. And how many solos did Tina get? This much. And I was definitely on Tina's side. I found it very unfair, the fact that just because Rachel tanked her audition, she gets to have the solo again because the fucking bitch from Niata was coming in for regionals or nationals or whatever, and Rachel wanted to impress her. I just found, and again, Rachel's only thinking about herself because it's of her, again, it's her future. I get it. But it's like, girl, you tanked. And I like how when Rachel, like, you know, when Rachel fights for her solos, it's kind of like handed to her. But when Tina fights for solos, she's being selfish. Please. Okay, so this is the episode that I wanted to talk about. So in this episode, they also do like a whole Freaky Friday switcheroo thing where Tina sees how it is to be Rachel and stuff like that, and sees how much, and she ends up like having respect for Rachel for all that she does. But this is the episode where, you know, Coach Beast theoretically left her husband, but she ends up going back to him, right? Because he said he's not going to do it again. Typical abuser, physical abuser, domestic violence type of person, where they say, I'm not going to do it again. He ends up doing it again, right? And they show a clip of Coach Beast holding a knife because she was getting ready to stab him, but she lets go of the knife and she doesn't do it. And then this is the episode also where Puck got like beat up in the poor fucking, in the port, and he got sent to the trash can. Again, Puck, I was rooting for you, bruh. I was rooting for you. So then, you know, Coach Beast, I want to say, shows him the knife and says, I was going to use, she's like, I've been sleeping with a knife these past couple days because, you know, you have been hitting me, da 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 da. And then I think she takes her wedding ring off and gives it to him. And then he's like, so you're going to leave me? And then he said, and I quote, who's going to love you? Who's going to love you? And she says, me. And I was like, yes, bitch, yes. Like I said, and again, this is why I didn't make the immediate video right then and there. This is what I'm talking about. It's like, if your man won't respect you and love you, do that for yourself. Don't have a man validate you. Validate yourself. And I was so proud of Coach Beast. I was like, yes, bitch, go off, bitch. I was rooting for her. That made me feel amazing. That is why I didn't go off on a video right then and there. I loved how she just put the ring down and he's like, who's going to love you? Because again, remember, and I was thinking this before I even watched that episode where she said, who's going to love me? Nobody else is going to love me. I'm pretty sure that was a psychological thing he was putting on her to make her believe that. But she said, no, I'm going to love myself if you're not. If nobody's going to love me in this world, I'm going to love myself. And that is the way I feel. Quick little story time, actually. My aunt, she is, I have to thank her. She is the reason why she's the foundation of our family. But homegirl, she's innocent as can be. My aunt, she's an innocent. She's like 62 years old, lovely woman. But she could be pretty gangsta. Let me tell you what happened. So she has been with her husband now for 44 years, I want to say, maybe. With the same man. There was an era where he's like maybe 6'2", 6'3", okay? And she's like 5 feet, you know? And there was a point where he was physically abusive towards her. He would hit her. He would, you know, not, like, he would, like, give her bruises. He would, you know, all that stuff, right? And there came a point where she got sick of it, right? So what ended up happening was he came home drunk, I think, and she was sick, right? So she had a screwdriver, and she was just like this. And he was getting ready to slap her ass, like, eh. What did she do? As soon as that hand came up on her, that screwdriver goes right through his hand. Because my aunt got sick of him always beating her. So when Coach Beast said that she was getting ready to stab him, that's a thing. Because it happened firsthand with my aunt. Long story short, her husband was drunk, so I'm pretty sure he didn't really feel the pain, maybe. And then he ends up going to the hospital. And he never hits her again. And they're still married to this day. It's people put their foot down on many different ways. Coach Beast decided to leave and not stab him. My aunt decided to stab him and stay. People do things their own way. But yes, like I said, love yourself. Don't think about being single as a bad thing. Think about it as a triumph, as in you are saving yourself for someone who truly deserves you. Think about it that way. That's the way I see it. Don't step on my level if you aren't on my level. And that's the way I think about myself. Okay, so let's talk about the Nationals episode. Let's talk about the performances, because it was mainly circled around the performances. So Vocal Adrenaline, New Directions went first. It was okay. Their performance was good. What I want to talk about is Vocal Adrenaline. They had Unique as, you know, the main vocalist, which was really cool. But they really didn't choose the best songs for Unique. I noticed that Vocal Adrenaline has better dancing and mediocre singing. And New Directions has better singing, but mediocre dancing. I feel like the fact that they chose a Nicki Minaj song for Unique's performance, like literally, like Unique has these amazing vocals. Why don't you choose music that will accentuate, that will showcase her vocals? Again, they're trying to make New Directions win. That's how the plot line's supposed to go. But y'all could have chose a better song choice for Unique. The second song was better. I don't remember the second song choice, but it was a lot better than fucking Nicki Minaj, Starships. I do like Starships, but that song, not good for, you're supposed to showcase your singing, not rapping. But New Directions ends up winning Nationals. Finally, they end up winning Nationals. And the woman from NIADA, Carmen Thibodeau, she was actually in the audience and she was very impressed with Rachel's performance. Because, you know, Rachel choked in her first performance singing Don't Rain on My Parade. So let's talk about the final episode, which was the goodbye episode. And basically a lot of this episode showed a lot of flashbacks between the two. You know what I'm saying? Like they showed flashbacks of like the main cast, like Rachel, Finn, Kurt, Quinn, about like what was it like when you first entered high school versus what it is now. And Kurt was talking about how like he made an impact on being gay or whatever, being gay in high school, which I can totally relate to, because to be honest, like I said, like Kurt was like the only gay out person at the time. I was not the only gay out person. There were obviously other people in my school who were gay, but I was the only one who looked like this. You know, I still had high school me. So I look like this, you know what I'm saying? Like, and people obviously knew. If they didn't know, they would get a clue obviously by looking at me. Like that's the way I looked. And I was the most obvious out person. There's other people who were out, but they couldn't pass for mask or for straight or whatever. I couldn't. I obviously stuck out. I stuck out and I always do. But I can totally relate to Kurt at that point, because I do feel like I definitely, like, I feel like for me, like, I hoped that other people that were in the closet or whatever saw me. They can see that, you know, you can be more out there with what you want to experiment with. Because like I said, when I was in high school, I was experimenting with hair extensions. I was painting my nails. You know, like, I didn't care at that point. I just wanted to be me. And I know there's some people who have some reservations about that because they're afraid they're going to get bullied and blah, blah, blah. But I personally wasn't afraid of that. I would just call for backup. But yeah, like I honestly, like, hopefully that for me personally, I hope it inspired people that were in the closet to actually like be able to express themselves, even if it's in the non-conventional way. And something that I found so cute was the fact that Kurt's dad asks him to come to the auditorium, and he tells him about how when he first, like, the day that he found out that he was gay or whatever, not really the day, but when he, you know, did all when he first saw him like performing like a gay number or something, was Beyonce Single Ladies, and freaking Kurt's dad ends up doing the number. I found that so adorable, to be honest. Like, I knew he was gonna do a number. I didn't know it was to that song, and I found the symbolism super cute. The fact that, you know, Kurt did it on the episode that he came out, and then Kurt's dad is recreating it. I thought that was super, super cute. So other things that happened, Mercedes got a background to be a background singer. Quinn was trying to get with Puck again or something. And also something that I found really weird was that Puck needed to pass a final class in order to graduate. He needed like one class to pass, which I found really strange. He's like, I'm going to repeat 12th grade. I'm like, don't you just graduate through summer school? Is summer school not a thing anymore? I mean, I went to 2 years of summer school and I passed. I never needed to repeat a grade, but that's beside me. So they also show a scene where Rachel, Finn, and Kurt are in the Glee classroom and they have their acceptance letters if they got in or not. Finn applied for like an actor program. Rachel and Kurt applied for this, for the NIADA thing. Rachel's the only one who got accepted, right? And basically, she got accepted, which meant that Finn wasn't going to New York with, you know, because he didn't get into the acting thing. So what ends up happening is at the end of the episode. Oh, also, I forgot to mention, Puck actually passed. So he's graduating. But anyway, Rachel and Finn were supposed to get married, right? And they're supposed to, I think, go to the church. And then Finn stopped at the train station. And Rachel's like, why are we at the train station? And he said, you're going to go to New York. And she's like, no, I said I would stay in Ohio for you. And he's like, no. He's like, I'm not going to stop you from achieving your dream. He's like, you're going to go to New York and be a star without me. And she's like, no, like, I want to stay here with you. And he's like, I'm enlisting in the army. And if our love is strong, we will get through this. And she's like, so you're breaking up with me? I'm not getting goosebumps just even talking about it. She's like, you're breaking up with me? I can't believe it. And he's like, I'm letting you go to achieve your dream. He's like, I don't want you to settle. I don't want you to give up your dreams because of me. That's what I'm talking about. Rachel settled for her dreams to be with her man. Didn't I just say that when you're in a relationship with somebody, they hold you back from your dreams? I said it. So basically, he lets her go so she can live out her dream. I've said it once, I said it twice, I said it every time. I'm not a fan of Finn by any means, but I think that's one of the most noble things that somebody could do. Although Rachel may feel like that hurts in that moment, but the fact that he wasn't selfish and he's not like, oh, well, she's staying for me. That's amazing. He was actually considerate of your passions. And he's like, I want you to achieve your passions. Wow. I found that crazy. I was not expecting that ending. But I also find that very noble of him. The fact that he's able to put his needs aside. He's able to take himself out and think about another person. That's amazing. Because, you know me. If I was like, guess what? I want to move to California, do this shit. And the person I'm with is like, I don't want to do that. I'm going to be like, bye, bitch. You know, there's, again, sometimes you have to compromise your dreams for some people. Like, what if you want to relocate to another state and work there? What if you want to take a job abroad and your partner doesn't? Are you going to settle for your partner? You know, so I found that very noble of Finn to do. I was totally not expecting that, to be honest. And I know Rachel's hurting right now. But, you know, at the end, it's like, again, as selfish as Finn has been these past two seasons, that is probably one of the most noble things that he can do. Amazing. Amazing, honestly. I was very moved by that. The fact that he actually was giving up his happiness for her to achieve her dream. And yeah, she wants to be with him and she was willing to give up, well, 1 year, but she was willing to give up going to New York to be with him. But again, that just goes to show you're giving up your dream just to be with me. Final thoughts. This video is super long. I'm gonna have to edit it into a fucking all day. But I am very, 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 I was fairly impressed with this season. It was okay. I still love season one. I still love season one. This season was, the main consensus of the season was just like literally Rachel and Finn getting engaged. Rachel and Finn, NIADA. That's all I could think of. But yeah, that is just basically all I have to say. Pero se, I've been filming for 2 goddamn hours, so I'm gonna edit this. We'll see. Anyway, until next time. Bye.